work. And we do use some plenty of technology, so I think I'm still relevant to this. So some of the other organizers that we have here, I'll let them introduce themselves as well. So we have Dylan.
Yeah, so my name's Dylan. I'm a PhD student in the NIMA Center in CIT, so my area of research is security and software-defined networks. So myself, I don't do too much with Google technologies and kind of spoken to this as a way of learning about some more technologies.
Nice.
We have Tarinjan, who's like the original organizer.
My name is Tarindu, I'm from Sri Lanka, doing my PhD here in CIT on blockchain and IoT. So I used to work for GDG in Sri Lanka, and when I came here, I thought of doing it here also. So that's how the group started.
And last but not least, we have Indika.
Yeah. Hi guys, I'm also from Sri Lanka. I'm finally a PhD student in CIT. And my research area is cognitive radio, wireless sensor networks. So, yeah.
So that's the team. So we have some really exciting events that we'd like to do this year. We'd like to get the word out a little bit better, so we'll have bigger meetups hopefully in the near future. But what we plan on doing is things like workshops. We'll have some speakers hopefully coming down from Google in Dublin, so some experts in the field. And if you stick around long enough, we might get Google to send us some swag as well. and we have two talks planned for this evening. One is by Carlos here, and he's going to be deploying an instance to the cloud for us, showing us how to do that. And then we're going to look into TensorFlow by Kishan, I think is his name. And that's going to be over, is it WebEx or Hangouts or something? It's going to be a virtual one anyways. So we'll let Carlos go.
Okay, here we go. So I made this presentation with the official logo. So we are going to start by showing how to deploy an instance to Google Cloud. Oh, first of all, who I am. I'm Carlos Mateo, I'm Catalan, not Carlos, it's my Catalan name. I'm living here in Cork, working as cloud architect for Viking Enterprise, which is part of Sanmina. My experience in the cloud is wide. I've been CTO in several companies. I've been also software development manager there. I created a multi-cloud project, which is called EasyManage, that won an European contest and allowed to manage the instance from several work providers from the same dashboard. And I also helped Google when they launched the Google Cloud Compute Engine. I absolutely love that. So you can check that if you want. It's from 2015. From this time, I helped the team to fix some things. Now things are better, are much better, more interesting. Okay, well, I have this on my Twitter. I created a messenger in 96, which is something I love to comment. So let's go. Okay, so how will it work? This talk is only 20 minutes. So what I'm trying to do is to concentrate the most value for you in that small amount of time. So we will cover a lot of things. We will start with deploying just one instance, and then we will grow in complexity. I think you will find it very interesting. All right, I also provide some side stuff that is cool for sysadmins. You will know some tools in here that probably you will like and use in other projects. And let's go for it. Okay. First of all, about Google Cloud Engine. They are competing fiercely with Amazon, Microsoft, and there are other players in the scene like Oracle, for example, IBM, and they are all fighting for this. And Google is not as big as Amazon or Microsoft, but they are like trying to compete in this scenario. What I like from Google Cloud Engine respect to others, the network, the speed of the network is amazing, absolutely amazing. I raised this question like, okay, if I have a website in your network, will I have like better rank? Because the latency is super low. And they had to ask internally, and they said, no, you will not have better rank for this, but you will have very good rank for the network part, which is good. So not for being in the Google's network, but just for having a very good network. So to get an idea, for example, I was pinging Google from home. I have a 360 megabit at home, and it took like 15 milliseconds. And from one instance, the most simple and slow instance, it was taking 0.3 milliseconds. So it's 50 times less, so 50 times faster. I pointed that the no advantage for SEO other than having a very good network, which is cool. Something that I also like is that they do nice discounts. If you use an instance all the month, for example, you can get to 30% of discount or more. I think 30% is the top. But they do automatically. You don't have to do anything. Other providers make you like reserve for a year or whatever, and then you get the discount. That's done automatically in your favor, which is good. And I love also that they have really powerful instance with many cores and a lot of RAM. That's something that not all of them have. So okay, I introduced you the free tier. So you can test by yourself. In the free tier you have $300 and you can use it for 12 months. So you can try yourself, which is good for free. There are some things that I don't like that I will comment now. Something that it's funny, but if I don't recommend you to try at work, because if you have your email from work and you have your email from home, it automatically will select your primary. So probably you will be creating the account in the work's account, and that's something that you don't want to. Also, to activate the free trial, you need to provide a Visa card, a payment card. And after you will not be able to delete it. So I have special cards for those things. So just know. I raised an issue with support about that, but it doesn't seem that they are gonna fix that. Because they consider that you have to have a valid payment method in the system.
So you can't do a free trial without giving them money?
No. Well, they will not charge. They will not charge, but they will keep your Visa. So, and even if you delete the account, it will be kept. So I ask about that. So I don't like that, but I share with you. Mm-hmm. So if you can, or if you want to try it, you can use a credit card that is gonna expire, or you can use a card that you charge money into, or it's just a tip. And the web interface has some problems of refresh. Sometimes you have to refresh manually because otherwise you don't get the data refreshed. That's a problem they have. So that's a basic image of the dashboard. We will get into there. Okay, so when we create a new instance, first we determine the zone where we are creating. They have different zones in the States and Europe, Asia, and the price change. The price is per minute and change depending on which zone you choose. I mentioned about the discounts here. Something that is very nice is that when you launch an instance, you will have an internal IP address. This internal IP address can communicate to other instances on the same zone, and in other zones as well. And later I cover about that because it has many advantages. Like you are not gonna be charged for that traffic, for example. It's a traffic that I have found to be at 2 gigabit per second. And it's good if you need, like, you have websites, for example, web servers, and you communicate with the database or with the storage or whatever internally, you will not be charged for that traffic if it's in the same zone, which is nice to know. So you only will be charged for the traffic that you generate with the external IP addresses. About security, for the disk encryption, you can provide your own keys, so they don't know what data is in your drive. That's interesting. Otherwise, you can trust in them and they will scan everything. So,
So they can use their own keys. Another tip when creating an instance, I recommend you to use always the same distribution because it's much more easy to handle and it's much more easy later to know where the scripts to update. In this case, I recommend Ubuntu because it has the biggest share of quota and the versions LTS, the long-term support that they compromise to give you support. I think it's 4 years. Okay. About the internal network, okay, yeah. Each instance has its own internal IP address. You can create more networks and you can do interesting stuff with the networks as well. But by default, it comes with an internal IP address. The traffic between them is free, I commented that already. Something that is interesting as well is that the traffic with the Google products, it's free also. So if you are querying heavily Maps or Drive or YouTube, that's not, will not suppose a charge to you. So that's very interesting for startups. Depending on the things that you do, you will love that. I try to detect the speed of the link, but I don't know if you see, but it's not reported. So if you cut from CIS class net, the name of the interface and the speed, it says -1. And if you use Ethernet tool, it says unknown here. But I tried with IP performance, and it takes 1.96 gigabit per second, so it's not bad at all. That's the speed. Okay, an interesting thing about the disk, additional disk that you can add, is that the biggest you provision, the more IOPS they will provide to you. So that's something that is not clear when you create a small drive. You see that it's not very, very fast. So, but then you realize, or if you look at the documentation, that the biggest you make the size of the drive, you get more IOPS. They have a very nice now simulator. So when you enter the size of the drive, it says what's the speed that you will get on the IOPS. Using additional disk is not a very good idea sometimes, especially with auto-scaling, because it takes some time to provision that. So if you are auto-scaling and you have heavy load on your systems, you want those new instances to come as fast as possible. So if you get like a delay of 2 minutes, for example, that's not good. So I don't recommend like to attach additional disks to instances that has to be auto-installed and spawned. So what I recommend is to use a dedicated storage. You can have your own instance or use Google's. If you use your own instance, you can have something like NFS, or you can create a ZFS if you create a dataset or a volume with ZFS. You can have compression in there. And you can also have write Z1, 2, or 3, which is equivalent to write 5 on traditional systems, or write 6, or write Z3 is parity 3. And one thing that is cool with ZFS is that you only rebuild the data that is present on the disk. You don't rebuild all the drive like the traditional write systems. Okay, so that's a comparison between the speed. That's for provisioning a small 500 gigabyte drive. You see that the speed for read and the speed for write, it's roughly 60 megabytes per second, which is not much. But then if instead of 500 gigabytes you provision 5 terabytes, it's 180 megabytes per second and 120 megabytes per second for writing. But you also can provision, and that's very interesting, SSD or NVMe drives locally attached to the servers. And that's much more faster. And in the case of those drives that are locally attached to the server, to the physical server, we use instance, but we have servers that are physical, So you can group up to 8 of those drives, and then the speed is multiplied. The speed is grouped. That's very nice if you need like to have more IOPS or more speed. You can use several of those SSD. This wizard is very nice. When I started with Google, they don't have that, and was difficult to calculate the IOPS. Now it's very easy. All right. Yes, you can provide your own public keys for your instance, or you can let Google use them. And they have an integrated SSH client on the web, which is very convenient. And you can copy and paste with Control C and Control V. You don't need to use like the Shift Control V like in the terminal of Linux. And also it's nice that special charts like accents or this special chart that is used in Catalan are supported directly, which is very nice. You know, many of the web emulators don't support. Okay, so this is a sample where you provide your public IP, public key for the instances that will be deployed. Okay, so let's do some demo. Okay, so we are opening now the section for the Google Cloud Computing Engine for the virtual machine.
Can you zoom into your screen just a tiny bit? I'm wearing glasses.
It's very small. It's very
small.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, you're right. Is better like that? So here we can see the instance that currently. Ready because I don't know how the time will come, so I wanted to have like something already prepared and just do everything live for you, but just in time if we don't have enough time, I have prepared something that I can show you very very fast. The thing is that when provisioning some operations take time, so okay, so we are going to create a new instance. We are going first, we will grow in complexity, so we start with the very, very basic. So we create a basic instance. In this case, we are using just one virtual CPU with almost 4 GB of RAM. And here we have the estimated price per month for this. We will recharge for the first minute, and after we will recharge for second, which is nice. But let's charge for hours. It's nice. So the options, I will choose to use an image from Ubuntu LTS. You can select from different flavors. There is also the possibility to use a commercial image. I will talk about that later. We have our Ubuntu. We will allow HTTP traffic for this machine, and if we wanted to provide better drives, well, additional drives, sorry, we can do from here, adding a new disk. That's something we are not gonna do because it will take more time, but we can provide. And here is the simulator I told you before, so if we wrote this, then automatically indicates. Okay. Also about encryption, you can select if you want Google to manage it or you to provide your own key. Okay. So that's it. Let's create this first instance. Very straightforward, very easy.
Is everything for the just done the UI, or can you do it through a CLI as well?
Oh yes, there is a CLI available, and we can just do the operations from the CLI as well. But it complicates just a bit the thing. Yes. For the demo's sake, I will go with the website. But yes, you can just use the CLI or call the API. So whatever you prefer. The previous versions, they provide in each operation a window with the command line call you can do to do the same. But now they made like more user friendly or less technical user friendly. Okay, so we have deployed this instance. Here is the internal IP address we have, and here is the external IP address that has been provided. This is ephemeral or dynamic. Will change every time we start the machine, while this will be kept. In some circumstances, they could change the internal networks, but they tend not to do it, except major cause. Okay, so from here, what I want to show you just is the SSH client. Now it's sending the keys to the web terminal. Okay, here we go. And it's nice because it works the ls. Okay, the up and down works perfectly, which is also that many emulators don't support. It's horrible. Okay. Oh, sorry. That's thing with the image, you deploy an Ubuntu image, but it could happen that it doesn't have the very, very latest upgrades. So when you start with a machine, I recommend to upgrade, to update and to upgrade. Now, I just wanted to launch this very basic instance to start, to show a few things. So you see the ping to Google, it's very fast. We can also ping 10.142.0.18. Okay. Another of the machines I have on the same network, another one that I launched. And it's very fast as well. Okay. And as I'm trying to show you very different things. For sure you all know TOP. I wanted to show for the ones that don't know HTOP, which is an improved version of TOP. It's very handy. And with the menus you can kill processes and do whatever. Okay. So that machine has accomplished its mission. And bye bye. Oh, I didn't sudo. Okay, we destroy from here anyway. Yes. Okay. I keep those other machines. I keep it just in case we don't have enough time. But I think we can. Okay, cool. So that's being destroyed. Now we are gonna create a new instance with something a bit more. So okay. Basically, we select the same. We select the same version of Ubuntu. Okay. Perfect.
HTTP traffic. And now we expand this, and on the startup script, we are gonna do something. Let me show you what I have copied. So I have copied a shell script in here, because the Google allow us the ability to deploy a startup script that will be launched on the first launch as root, so we can like configure things. Like in this case, sorry, I'm gonna make it big again. Full screen. Presentation mode. All right. So in this case, I do an update, I force an upgrade. I'm not putting sudo in front because this will be executed en route. Here is done on purpose. There is a note. Careful with dependencies. If you have a project that requires an exact version of Apache or whatever or any library, when you do upgrade, it can be upgraded and not work for you. So that's something I put here on purpose to show you. That's also not very interesting if you are auto-scaling, because it takes time. So, but it's important that you know those things. Also, I install Git and Apache, and then I just write this HTML file to the default file. So that's it.
Never remember how to exit the.
So that's what I have pasted in here. So that's exactly what I have pasted. All right. You have to be careful if you paste from Google Docs, because the quotes and things like that are changed. Silly things. Okay. So that's interesting. Well, metadata is a more advanced concept. You can query Google to know like what's the kind of instance, how many CPUs it has, a lot of things, and you can create your own keys, which is interesting. For example, if this machine has to connect to a SQL database, you can create a key that points to an exact IP or name that use it. So that's more advanced, it's interesting. And those other things, preemptibility and automatic restart, are interesting to know. This preemptibility means that you can use this machine for 24 hours as long as they have enough capacity, and then they charge much more or less. But if they don't have enough capacity, they shut down your machine. So for $24 is not per month, it's not a problem, but if you have many of them, maybe. Automatic restart, they are very clear with that, is that all right? If we need to upgrade our infrastructure, do you want us to auto start your machine after we have upgraded, or you want us to leave it shut down? So the recommended option is on. But the interesting side thing from this is to know that at some time they can shut down the servers if they need. So we have to know that. Is running the infrastructure, and that sometimes they can do some maintenance. In my experience, is not the usual, but sometimes they can. And also, this is the same. If they have to really do infrastructure maintenance, for example, if they discover a bug in one model of CPU of Intel, and then have to replace all of them and shut down everything, for example, they ask, do you want us to migrate this instance or just terminate? Terminate means that you will lose the disk unless you have specified not to delete the disk when you delete the instance.
by default, when we delete an instance, the drive is wiped and destroyed, but you can tell them to keep it. Okay, so we will just play with this new script, which is an important piece for automation, for a lot of things. That the startup script is key for many things. Here we are. The machine, you see that the machine has started, it has the green check. Okay, so we think that we are ready to go. But we are not, because the startup script is still running. And it will take approximately 1 minute to finish his work. That's important to know, because you can think that as the machine has started, everything is ready. No, the machine has booted, but then the process is launching the startup script. So this can take not a lot of time, but 1 minute or 2 minutes, depending on the case. But that's something I wanted to show you, because when you start with this, otherwise you can think, oh, I did something wrong, because it's not working. No. It's like it takes time, and those kind of things when you start eat a lot of time from you. So that's a trick. Okay. Well, we can do another thing and then come back in 1 minute or like that. So
we is there a way to configure that so that it only tells you that it's up once your script is finished?
So it is possible to configure.
So that it only so that the instance only shows green once your script has successfully run, but you can send it some
okay.
success message.
That's a very interesting question. It is not supplied by default, but you can do your own scripts. I provide a bash script, and I can like open a web CRL to point to one another server that registers when one server is up for real. Or you can have other software monitoring like Zabbix, for example, like checking for an exact pattern that will not come up until everything has been set. So it's up to you. So it's up to the companies can grow and make more sense to the tool. But that's it. Hello world. So that was what we echo. We have echoed that in here. To the default file, and that's it. Okay, so that was the very basic demonstration of the startup script, which is has a lot of importance for the things that we will see later. Okay, so you can use Bash or you can use Python, you can use different environments, but something important. Normally, when we write the scripts, we use emp environment, so we don't have to worry about if it's in a path or another, if it's in usr bin or if it's in usr local bin or whatever, the system manages it. But in this case, Google requires you to provide the exact path. If you use that, it will not work, and you will be asking why it doesn't work. So it's same with Python. Why I have to know the exact path. And normally when we do scripts, we use emp. But in this case, you have to provide the exact path. So just to save time for you when you start doing that. Okay. Okay, the instance templates. So that's a next step in complexity, which makes the tool much more powerful. The instance templates allow you to define the basic blueprints for an instance and reuse that and launch many instances from this template. This will be used for auto-scaling. So you can have your templates, for example, for deploying Redis or Memcache nodes, or web servers for auto-scaling, or the typical web server that you launch
once in a year, but you always want the same configuration to work. So you can have the templates for that, or a storage template with everything configured, database, whatever. But those are not so usual, because normally you launch this once and never again. You are not like expanding databases every day. But web servers for scaling, yes. So here I have created a script for the template of our web server, and it's just a bit more complex than the previous one. And what we will do in this case is, okay, update, upgrade, install Git, install those tools. Those are just nice tools. If you don't know some of them, you can look for them after, because they are very, very useful. But it's not required for the demo. For example, FatTrace is very cool, because it shows in real time which processes are modifying which files on the system. So when you are debugging things and people say, oh, I created the code and the code is updating the files, but I don't see it refresh on the file system, you can try that on real time and say, oh, no, it's not being written to the file, or it's writing to another path. So okay, here we installed Apache, MySQL server, and PHP, and the libraries to connect Apache with PHP. So basically we are deploying a LAMP web server. And then we clone from a Git project that I created just for this demo. And then we do some stuff like copying some files from this project that we deployed on under root core demo to the right path in var www.html, so the web server sees it. And I remove the full index.html page from Ubuntu. So that's what we are gonna do. Okay. We are gonna do live now. Okay. So I just copy this script from here. Okay. And here we go to instance templates. And we are gonna create an instance template. Normally I add dash TPL or dash LB for load balancer or dash whatever, so I know which object, what is the meaning. So we are gonna say, okay, for all the instances that we deploy with this template, we are gonna use one virtual CPU. The same is the minimal. Okay, we are gonna use Ubuntu again. We will allow HTTP traffic, and now we are gonna use the startup script again. Okay. Perfect. And create. There is an icon in here that indicates the number of events that had happened. So if we click, we see what we have been doing, like creating instance or deleting instance or whatever, the activities. Okay, so it has been created, perfect. So now we could like create a virtual machine based on that, just a simple, or we can create an instance group. We can create from this, but I want you to see the screen, so we will create from here. Okay, so create new instance group. Okay. So I named the same as before, with EG, IG, sorry, for instant group. Then we will deploy in a single zone only, in this one, which is the cheapest. Okay, we can select in here if we want to grow this group manually or let it automatically grow. We will let it automatically grow. And then we choose